I wonder how many of my fellow Canadians know that it is 250 years older than Halifax. And in fact, was an international seaport when New York was still a swamp. It is the oldest city in North America and the capital of Canada's youngest province. St. John's is a fine old city. It's not a beautiful city. It's not a wealthy city. But the wooden houses are painted brightly, and sometimes I feel the city looks more cheerful than some of the cities with nothing but stone and brick. Few cities have a signal hill and south side hills and an approach to the Atlantic which is romantic. St. John's has all these things. And I have been most fortunate to have had the honor, as Harry Mews, to be mayor of St. John's for a period of 16 years. Actually, 100 years before the Pilgrim Fathers landed on Cape Cod, St. John's boasted 40 or 50 homes permanently occupied by Europeans. On August the 8th, 1583, Sir Humphrey Gilbert landed in St. John's and formally laid claim to Newfoundland in the name of Queen Elizabeth, thus establishing England's first overseas colony. There's the battery over there. Rather a unique battery, inasmuch that we have no guns firing. But you know, down through the centuries, fishermen have lived in these little houses perched upon the cliffs, and they don't want to leave them. It was suggested that they might be given houses or assisted in obtaining houses in the city, but they want to be by the sea, and we all understand that. The harbor is almost completely landlocked. And during the early years, come spring and autumn, the harbor would be filled with vessels from all over the island. You see, St. John's was the only center of supply and credit in those days, and the fishery was financed from St. John's. Everybody came in to get their supplies, and then they sailed to the fishing grounds. It was a sight to see so many vessels putting out through the narrows and going along our coast to the places where they live. In 1949, Newfoundland became the youngest province of Canada. And some years after, the St. John's Harbor became a Canadian national harbor. You wouldn't know that the new harbor was built, as we might say, on the same site as the old one. Along the northern shore are completely new docks with loading facilities. Shipping coming to the harbor is increasing each year, and Newfoundland's economy having expanded, the harbor is without doubt a great asset to St. John's. One of the oldest countries dear to Newfoundland is Portugal. In the old days, they were one of our best customers, but they learned how to catch the fish themselves. Now they come into St. John's and buy supplies from us. They have the White Fleet, which leaves Portugal and is away for at least 6 months while they prosecute the fishery on the banks of Newfoundland or up in Iceland waters. They are charming people, They are here in hundreds, thousands sometimes. They never cause any trouble, and we are all very fond of them. Nearly every seaport has a Water Street, and so is St. John's. And it's the oldest street in North America. Not every port can say that. One time we had cobblestones, oh, what cobblestones. And the streetcars went along the tracks like Wadey Buckety. Despite the modern trend of recent years, there are still some old buildings to be seen. One by one, they've been disappearing. One by one, new buildings have been appearing. It wasn't until 1800 that Water Street was known as a street, and then it was only 6 feet wide and was referred to as the Lower Path. Today it is modern, a mixture of old and new, but changing every year. The oldest buildings are not as old as those which were destroyed by fire. Three times St. John's was nearly wiped out by fire. But here and there, there are some which would date back, I would say, to about 1830, or thereabouts. They are not, in my opinion, the most attractive ones. We lost the most attractive ones. The atmosphere, therefore, is a little higgledy-piggledy, if you know what I mean. It is neither one thing nor the other. In the old days, businessmen had their premises on Water Street, and they lived over them. It was a cozy arrangement, I would say. On dirty days, you didn't have to go out. But it was inevitable that that would change. And as St. John's is built on a hill, they went a little further up the hill, but not over the crest. But with the changes that came in this new era, the city expanded. It went up the hill, dipped into the valley beyond, and there the first new houses built by the St. John's Housing Corporation were established. Along this valley now runs the great development of government buildings, the great Confederation building, and the Memorial University, which has been enlarged, and which will in due course provide also a medical school for our students. Thank you. This new area will not grow like Topsy grew. It is carefully planned. The medical school will be planned by one of the finest architects in Great Britain. I'm very happy, as we all are, to know that the planning is in the hands of men who know what they are doing. It is not easy in St. John's to get the atmosphere. We don't have the soil, we don't have the large trees. It is a hard country. We have a lot of gravel. It is not easy to grow flowers, but we grow them. We persist. We have a railway in Newfoundland. In the old days, it was the Newfoundland Railway. It is now the Canadian National Railway. When it was first inaugurated, the station, the St. John's Station, was on the site of the present Hotel Newfoundland. And the train really encircled the town before it got out of it. It went up the avenue which we now know as the Old Track, or Empire Avenue. And it chewed its way up with a little narrow gauge, and everybody liked to see it. Then, in due course, the station was moved to the west end part of the town because the train can only go west. It can't go east unless it goes out in the Atlantic. And it was modernized. Now we find that the CNR and the Cross Country Express, sometimes called the Bullet, is finding it difficult to operate a passenger service because the passengers are going by automobile and by aeroplane. And plans are underway to replace the CNR passenger service with fine, modern, large buses, which will operate between here and Port of Ask. Everybody, of course, is sorry to see the old railway go. That is the passenger service, but modern methods are now necessary to help the railway give the service that is required. In the 1700s and the early 1800s, St. John's could be described very properly as a garrison city, or a garrison town then. And many forts were required to defend the city. For instance, Signal Hill was bristled with forts. And across the harbor, the Narrows, from Cabot Tower is now, there was Port Amherst. And there was the Fort William upon which the hotel now stands, the Newfoundland Hotel. And also there was the Fort Townsend, which is near the Basilica and is a police headquarters. And speaking of the forts, there are models of these forts in the St. John's Museum. And it's well worth visiting the museum, because these old models are most interesting. Other documents are there also, which will be interesting to people who are interested in the history of Newfoundland. Military Road is a very old road, and it led from some of the forts to the others, from the East End forts at Amherst and up to Fort Townsend. And on Military Road is the old garrison church. Very old church, built in 1836. And there's a great deal of sentiment for the old garrison church. And I expect it will stand just as long as they are able to keep it in good condition. And Signal Hill was the scene of many battles between the French and the English. It has always been a place where people want to go. We never forget the fact that it was on Signal Hill that Marconi picked up the first wireless signal, which was the letter S, to be relayed across the Atlantic. That was on December the 12th, 1901. Before that, Cabot Tower was used to signal the approach of ships to the harbor. The signal showed the type of vessel and also the house flag of the owner of the ship was flown. And nearly every merchant who owned ships had a telescope in his office. And when he was expecting his ship to come to port, he would look through the telescope to Cabot Tower to see what was signaled. There will always be a sentimental fondness for Cabot Tower and Signal Hill. It is part of the lives of the citizens of St. John. A remarkable man, Marconi. I would like to have met him, as did my grandfather, who was a member of the government at that time. It's amazing what they can do to brighten up a military base. Pleasantville over there used to be Fort Pepperell, where the Americans set up their first overseas base in 1941. And prior to that, during World War I, the first contingent of troops of the Royal Newfoundland Regiment trained there before they went to France. When the Americans left in 1960, they turned Pepperell over to the federal and provincial governments. And the buildings there are now used as either government offices or apartments. Just across the road from Pleasantville is historic Kittyvitty Lake, where nearly every year since about 1828, a regatta has been held on the first Wednesday in August. It's a 1 3/5 course, and is unusual in that the boats row up the lake, turn the buoys, and come back again. The fastest time ever for the course was 9 minutes, 13 and 4/5 seconds, set in 1901, and it's never been beaten. But the races aren't the only attraction on Regatta Day. For the many, many thousands of people who come to Kittyvitty, it's all the fun of the fair. Spring comes late in the city of St. John's. Too often the ice is coming down from the north and the cold winds blow in upon the city. Sometimes icebergs dot the horizon. Sometimes they almost come into the narrows of St. John's. There have been cathedral-like icebergs stranded off the coast. Gothic, you know, but terribly cold. Now you may wonder if we have any flowers, if we have any shrubs in this rather barren land. Yes, we have flowers. And the amazing thing is that when at last the wind turns to the westward, and the ice has left the coast. The gardens grow quickly, very, very quickly. There has been, within the last 5 or 6 years, a great deal of capital from the mainland invested in St. John's, as well as in other parts of Newfoundland. Now, very recently, there has been a huge development that is a very large commercial complex in the area known as the Kenmount area. But I'm happy to think, I'm happy to feel, I'm happy to know that despite all this, this wonderful development, we still have some of the salt of the earth, some of the groceries, who phone you and ask you what you want to order at the end of this week. The family grocer who delivers the groceries right into your home, and if you leave the back door open when you're going out, he'll put the frozen goods in your own refrigerator for you. Of course, this may be old style, but there's no reason why the new and the old can't go hand in hand. And I'm very glad that in Newfoundland we have these great commercial complex structures. And I'm very happy, too, that we have the good old grocer, the man who knows his groceries and knows his customers. The colonial building was first opened for the House of Assembly on the 28th of January, 1850. Construction began in 1847, and it was built entirely of stone, which was brought out from Cork in Ireland. In the colonial building, there were many mighty battles fought. It was the House of Assembly, and there, Newfoundland, after it, was granted responsible government, conducted its own affairs. Now, most of us realize that responsible government for Newfoundland represented, in many ways, the trappings of an elephant on a mouse, because 250,000 people, only with difficulty, could support responsible government, support the economy of Newfoundland without suffering, and they suffered. The story of Confederation is a story which, of course, reminds us of the bitter feelings and misunderstandings, remembering always that we were isolated, remembering always that we were an island all alone in the Atlantic, a long distance from the nearest point in Canada in days of travel. It is not surprising that perhaps we had the attitude and the outlook of people who are by themselves. A government house was built in 1828. And prior to Confederation, the governor was appointed, of course, by the British government, and invariably was an official from Great Britain. Today, of course, the lieutenant governors are Newfoundlanders appointed to represent Her Majesty. And they have carried on very well indeed the traditions of Government House. There are many citizens who sometimes come up to Signal Hill, not because they have to, but because they want to come up. Not because they have anything to do up here, but because they are tired, perhaps, of doing so much down in the city. There's something about Signal Hill. It lifts you above the ordinary things of everyday life. And as you look out over the city and see the basilica and the cathedral and all the churches, the brightly painted homes, You feel that it is a city of people. You hear still the putt-putt of the motorboat as the battery men come in from the fishing grounds. You see the changes that are taking place. It is not a sleeping port. The port is awake. Changes are taking place every day. The whole harbor has changed in concept and in use. It is not the harbor of 15 years ago or 10 years ago. It is the harbor of the New St. John's, forging ahead. A province which will find a prominent place among the provinces of prosperity in Canada. Our new homeland, the land we are all learning to love.